Well, the Discover Historic New England series continues at the Thomas Crane Public Library this month on Tuesday, July 24th from 7 to 8:30 p.m. It's a tour of the region's top 100 national landmarks as authors Patricia Harris, David Lyon make a presentation about their brand new book. But you're very lucky because they're here right now to give us a little preview. So David, Patricia, welcome, welcome. Welcome to both of you.
Well, thank you so much for inviting us.
Pleasure. Yeah. I'm really looking forward to learning about this latest project of yours, but I want to learn a little bit first of all about the both of you. So maybe David, if we can start with yourself and tell us a little bit about your background and your history.
Sure. Well, actually Pat and I have been writing together for more years than we care to admit.
Okay.
And this is, I think Historic New England is maybe our 35th or 36th book.
Oh. We
do a lot of writing in travel, food, fine art, and have done so for these many decades. You might know us more locally from the Boston Globe.
Okay.
But we also write for a number of national magazines and several publishers in the UK and here in the States as well.
So how did this partnership begin? You know, and either one of you, please chime in.
Please go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, David and I met a little bit more about our background before we became writing partners. David was a poet and a co-publisher of a literary magazine, and I worked for what was then called the Massachusetts Council on the Arts and Humanities. And among my other responsibilities was funding for literary publications. And so we met kind of years ago through a shared interest in writing.
Did you both have a shared interest in history and landmarks and things of that nature?
I think that came along later.
Okay.
I mean, the truth is we started writing together particularly for the Globe, like I said, these many years ago.
Right.
And the magazines we were writing for, too, we were general feature writers. But we were traveling all over the country, and we decided, well, wait a second, there's this section called travel. So let's start writing travel stories as well as the general feature stories, because we've already spent the money on the airplane tickets. So about 1985, we got into writing travel a great deal, and that sort of evolved into writing more about food, and the historic landmark thing happened actually more serendipitously, because we write a lot about New England,
sure.
And as you said, we put thousands and thousands of miles on several cars driving all over New England, and you had a good way of putting it.
Well, we were sort of, a lot of historic landmarks are kind of what you would expect, like the John Adams and John Quincy Adams houses, you know, here in Quincy, mm-hmm. which are just fascinating, but we became quite surprised that there were all these other really quirky national historic landmarks. Submarines, windjammers, the first bird sanctuary in the United States, carousels, things that were really kind of unexpected. So, and it started to kind of fascinate us what kind of story about New England and what we value we could learn by kind of looking at the variety of national historic landmarks. And in fact, we have here in New England, there are about 400 altogether, so it was very hard to narrow it down to 100.
Yeah.
And in fact, New England, only New York and California have more than us, which in a way I was kind of surprised.
Yeah.
We'd have more than New York.
I would think so too, yeah, just because it kind of started here, right? Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
But it became kind of fascinating to see, well, what do people really value that rises to that status? And I think that's what got us going on working on the book.
So I guess it begs the question, you know, how did you narrow it down to the top 100 that you're calling it?
Yeah, the first thing we did was we eliminated all those that are hard to get to.
Okay.
Or that you can't, you know, that are not real accessible to the public. I mean, a beautiful National Historic Landmark is the Whaling Church in Hingham, which dates from the 17th century. But, you know, unless you're going to go to church there, you're not going to see it. It's not open to tour.
I see.
You know, and it's a marvelous thing, but reluctantly we said, well, you know, you can't get there most of the time. 6 days a week, you can't visit it.
Oh.
So that's out.
Okay.
And then we took out the ones where there frankly isn't a whole lot to see. I mean, there's like a pasture in Worcester, outside of Worcester, with a little bronze plaque in the middle of it. that says this is where Robert Goddard set off his first rocket.
Oh, interesting.
You know, which is interesting,
yeah, but
there's not a lot of there.
Are you going to drive, you know, from like Falmouth to Worcester to see this little black
exactly.
or something?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Exactly.
And then at that point, we still had, you know, several hundred left.
Yes.
And so we said, okay, everything that's on the Freedom Trail and everything that's part of Minuteman National Historic Park, because there are books and books and books and books about those.
Sure.
So we'll take those out. We'll acknowledge them in the introduction, but we won't use them. So therefore, the Paul Revere House is not in the book, but Trinity Church and the Boston Public Library are.
Oh, okay.
You know, because they're not on the Freedom Trail, and they're frankly much less visited, at least by people wanting to look at them from a historic standpoint.
Yeah, but did it have to actually meet certain criteria to be considered historic?
That's the National Park Service.
Okay.
Yeah.
The criteria, the program began in 1934, but it was really revived and became a major program in 1960, and at which point Massachusetts had like about the first 50.
Okay, yeah, sure.
And they had to be places that, places of particular interest that had, I can't remember exactly the phrasing of it.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But it had to, interpreting or representing the history of the United States.
Okay.
But that's been interpreted fairly broadly, as mm-hmm. Pat was saying. You know, so it's not just old houses of rich men.
Right.
You know, it also includes Revere Beach.
Okay.
You know, which is the first public beach in America.
Right.
You know, and includes some many authors' homes. It includes, you know, places in the landscape like Walden Pond, because, you know, Thoreau did a lot of thinking there.
Sure, sure. You know,
and somehow that it's palpable.
Okay.
You know, there are landscapes that show up as historic landmarks.
Yeah.
That are fascinating.
So, Pat, if you could kind of give us a little overview of how the book is formulated, how it's set up. Does it take us from, you know, what you consider number one to number 100, or is it regional, or how does it work?
Well, we back down from making any kind of categorization
okay.
of
okay.
the 100 in terms of, you know, quality or
right.
own interest. So it's regional, honestly. We did it by state,
oh.
and then we tried to group them so that you could make little day trips out of them,
okay.
you know, the ones that are closest
great.
Together.
Almost like a travel guide.
Oh, it is almost like a travel guide. Yeah, exactly. And, you know, because the truth is, it's funny, we've been starting to give these talks, and a lot of people have been telling us afterwards that it's just what they've been looking for, to do day trips.
Yes.
And then I'll say, well, it's a great idea, but if you look, here's three or four that are very close together, so make it a weekend.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay.
So.
Now I notice on the front cover here you have the Union Oyster House.
Yes.
So
that wasn't our doing.
Oh.
That was the publisher's
okay.
choice.
All right.
But it's turned out to be a fortuitous choice, because every place that we give this talk, somebody has a story about the Union Oyster
well,
House.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Mm.
You know, they used to go there with their grandparents,
yep.
or one guy who actually worked on the restoration of the facade. You know, it's been actually kind of fascinating.
Yeah.
Are there other photographs in the book?
There
yes,
are.
It's actually really heavily illustrated.
There's two to three photos
for every site.
Oh, there are. Okay.
Yeah.
Except for the Franklin Pierce House in New Hampshire.
Right.
Because there's a picture of it from across the street, because the person who was running it wanted to charge us $10,000 to take a picture because they thought we were using it as a movie set.
Oh, yeah.
So no, there's no picture of the interior.
Okay, interesting. That's a funny story, actually.
It is a funny story.
Yeah.
And I thought, boy, you must think writers get paid a lot more than they do.
Right. Yeah. Right. Now, is this your first kind of book together? I mean, do you make the transition? It seems from newspapers and magazines to authors.
Well, we've done a lot of more traditional travel guides.
Okay.
For example,
okay.
the Eyewitness and Top 10 series that most people know, because they're the ones with gorgeous photos and diagrams. They're published by Dorling Kindersley.
And we put the stuff that goes between the pictures.
Yeah, gotcha.
You know? Yep. Okay.
So, but it's our first, we think of it as perhaps a more personal book,
oh.
you know, because it's more of an essay style book, and all the decisions, which some were very difficult, and we know there are people who are disappointed, but they're ours. We weren't so much being guided by an editor or following a format of a guidebook series where every book has to be very similar.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's a kind of a departure for us, I would say.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. And you know, setup wise, is it each chapter is a different landmark or
exactly?
Oh, there is. Okay.
And it works frankly from south to north.
Yep.
And west to east.
Okay. Okay. And about how long are the chapters?
The whole book is 85,000 words.
Okay.
So that's about 850 words average.
Oh,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah, they're pretty short.
They're fairly short.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's really a setup to have in the car with you or
exactly.
on the train or.
Exactly.
Yeah, okay.
Exactly.
You know, yeah. Fun. What's going to be happening here at the library? Talk about your presentation again. It's July 24th from 7 to 8:30 p.m. What can folks expect?
Well, we'll talk a little bit. Pat usually gives the introduction, and then we sort of summarize much of what we've talked about here.
Yeah.
Of why we did it and how we did it, how we went about it, and then each one of us talks briefly about our favorite landmark from each of the six states. So
great.
The 12 little précis.
Yeah.
You know, they're not as long as the chapters, but you know, along with pictures.
Yes, yeah. Of course.
Because we actually.
So Franklin Pierce isn't in there.
But we shot most of the photos in the book. So
yourselves.
So it's heavily illustrated with slides, and
okay.
people seem to enjoy it. They've told us to move out of the way because we're blocking them. And they've told us to like turn off the light so they can see them
better. Oh, interesting. Okay.
Yeah. One place we had to like. And read our text with the phone.
Interesting. Okay. Well, that means you've hit a core then, because folks are interested.
So. People do, I were happy because people do seem to relate to it.
Yeah.
And everyone has a story about a place that they wish was a National Historic Landmark
right.
or something. So it seems to strike a chord. It's nice.
Yeah, and there's always somebody in the front row, as there was at one recent place, where one was
checking off.
I've been to seven of them.
Oh, is that funny? Okay, you know, all right.
Yeah,
so it could be a bucket list book, right?
About, yeah.
One woman told us that. She said, this is going to be my New England bucket list. So I think that's really nice, but it proves that people, and you're here in such a historic city, I think it proves that people are really interested in the history of this region.
Yeah, no, I think that's true. And I think, you know, to have something that kind of speaks to them, whether they're just, you know, armchair history buffs or perhaps studying, you know, history, or have experienced a lot of these places, would like to see what other people think of them.
Exactly. And we hope, I think people tend to be surprised, because one of the things I show is a submarine, and who would have thought?
Who would have thought that would
be a National Historic Landmark, but in fact there are three.
Huh.
So
who knew?
Exactly. Right. And that's what we kind of hope, that we some things are predictable, but we hope we surprise people too with some of the choices.
And I'm not going to ask either one of you to give away your favorite spots, because I want folks to come,
to come okay.
out and see the presentation. But thank you for coming here and sharing your story.
Thank you.
It was our pleasure. Thank you for having us. And I have to say, we're really looking forward to going to the library, just walking
by it. What
a
beautiful building.
Oh, it's
stunning.
Beautiful.
Yeah, it really is. It's quite a local gem for sure.
Yeah, so we're looking forward to it very much.
Great. Well, enjoy your presentation, and thanks for coming by here to tell
us. It's our pleasure. Thank you.
You're welcome. And again, if you'd like to get more information about this or any of the programs at the library, go to their website, thomascranelibrary.org.